Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Environmental Science. Today, we're diving into a topic that might seem a bit icky at first. It involves dead things and decomposition, or rotting. As gross as it may look, decomposition is vital to the functioning of an ecosystem because it allows the nutrients stored in a dead organism to be recycled and used again. Without it, life on Earth would have ended a long time ago. Today, you'll do more than just watch a video about decomposition. You will be completing a hands-on experiment to see it in action. As part of this lab activity, we'll be focusing on how to ask scientific questions that guide our experimental design. Since we're talking about questions today, I want you to come up with one. Yes, right now. Pause the video. Don't think too hard. Record the first question about any topic that comes to mind. Did you write something down? By the end of this lesson, you'll be able to determine whether the question you wrote down was scientific or not. And if it's not, don't worry. You'll know how to change it so that it is. Let's get started. Decomposition is nature's way of recycling. It's the process by which organic substances are broken down into simpler forms of matter. Look at this watermelon, for example. Over time, mold and bacteria break it down. What's left will return to the earth, providing nutrients for new life. After all, the watermelon has no use for its stored nutrients now. And it's not just about rotting fruit. Everything organic, the fallen leaves in your backyard, the leftovers in your kitchen, and even animals that have completed their circle of life, all of these go through this process. If we could peer underground into the soil, we would see fungi working tirelessly to decompose dead plant matter. While it might look gross at first, focus instead on the outcome of its labors. New seedling plants, nourished by the fungi's recycled nutrients, begin to sprout. Because of decomposition, new life can be born so that the cycle continues. But not all decomposition happens at the same rate. What abiotic factors do you think affect how fast or slow something decomposes? Pause the video for a moment and make a prediction. As you complete the lab, you'll test some of these factors. Have you ever carved a jack-o'-lantern and left it on your front porch for several days or weeks? What starts to happen to it? You probably know that it starts decomposing, looking even scarier than it did before. But you might have also noticed that sometimes it decays quickly, while on other occasions, you may have gotten away with leaving it out for a much longer period of time before it started looking scary for reasons other than its intricately carved face. What abiotic factors affect these varying outcomes? The two abiotic factors you will investigate in your lab are temperature and moisture. Do you think your jack-o'-lantern and other organic matter will decay faster or slower when the temperature is warm? And what about moisture? When organic matter is wet, will this slow down decomposition or speed it up? Pause the video and make some predictions in the table in your notes. After you complete the lab, you can see if your predictions were right. To complete the experiment, here are some of the materials you will need to gather up. Some old pieces of food, such as fruit, several sealable plastic bags, several scoops of potting soil, a thermometer, access to water, rubber gloves to protect your hands, and two places within your home that have different temperatures, one cool and one warm. You'll be adding your food pieces to four different bags of soil. Two of the bags will be used to compare the effect of temperature, and two will be used to compare the effect of moisture. You'll need to examine your bags for at least several days and possibly several weeks before you can make your conclusion. You'll find specific instructions in the lesson PDF. Did you know that every great scientific discovery starts with a question? But not just any question, a scientific question. These questions are special because they help us focus our curiosity and guide our experiments. What do you think determines whether a question is scientific? Let's consider our decomposition experiment. One variable you won't test today is sunlight, but you certainly could. So let's imagine that we were interested in how sunlight affects decomposition. How could we phrase a scientific question to begin our exploration? What if I said, is sunlight good for decomposers? This question has our two key words in it, decomposers and sunlight. But thinking about our requirements for a scientific question, objective, testable, and specific, can you think of any drawbacks to this particular question? Which word in the question is throwing us off? The word good is often problematic in a scientific question. Whether or not something is good can be a matter of opinion, so it's not objective. It is also difficult to test good. How do we know if we've achieved it? This question doesn't give us any defined goal or criteria to meet, so it's not specific enough. What about this one? Should we use sunlight for decomposition? Do you see another word here that could throw off our experiment? It's best to avoid the word should when making a scientific question. Not only does the word should often lead us down the path of opinion, it also tends to focus too much on declaring a future action rather than the real goal of an experiment, which is explaining the relationship between different factors. A scientific question needs to be definitively answerable based on data from an experiment. Knowing this, and knowing some words to avoid, see if you can write a better question that is more scientific about decomposition and sunlight. Pause the video for a moment and record what you come up with in your notes. Did you write a question? I wrote one down too. Let's analyze mine and see if it's scientific, and then you can make a judgment about your own. My question says, for a piece of fruit in soil, will increasing sunlight increase the rate of decomposition? Is it objective? I don't see anything in this question that could possibly be a matter of opinion. Is it testable? Well, it seems to me that we could try increasing the sunlight in our decomposition experiment and see if the rate of decomposition increases as a result. So, this is testable. And lastly, is it specific? Notice I used the word increase for both sunlight and decomposition. This gives us a clear direction as to which factor to change and how, and it also gives us a specific outcome to look for. The question also specifies that this is for a piece of fruit in soil, so we are not trying to prove a general rule for all cases of decomposition, which would be much harder. So, this is a scientific question. What about your question? Ask yourself, is it objective? Is it testable? Is it specific? If it's lacking in any of those areas, see if you can adjust it a bit. Apply these rules to both the question you just wrote about our decomposition experiment and to the question you wrote at the beginning of this video. In the lesson PDF, you'll get some more practice at writing scientific questions and learn some additional strategies to help you avoid writing questions that fall into the trap of opinion and generalities. As we went through the lesson today, we reviewed the process of decomposition and introduced the decomposition experiment that you will complete. You'll find the instructions for this experiment in the lesson PDF. We also considered how to write a good scientific question. After practicing some more in the lesson PDF, you'll put your new skill to use by writing a scientific question for your decomposition experiment. Next time, we'll review and get ready for the unit assessment. Until then, remember, you're a force of nature, so keep sparking the changes that you want to see. I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.